First of all, thank you all for coming. I just heard that the inventor of Twig is maybe showing up here, which makes me absolutely freaking nervous. But that's another thing, because you're going to see how I'm going to butcher his beautiful language. Fabian, are you here? He's not here. No? No, Fabian. Good. He's secretly hiding. The Twig Lab, I wanted to call it Fuck It, Ship It, but we got to call it Twig It, Ship It instead. That was a little bit more appropriate. We're going to run a simple thing. The first, we're going to talk about theme stuff from the front end. Then we're going to have some nerdy stuff called Twigify, a demo of that. Then we're going to talk about how you as developers can create new wonderful Twig files for us themers. And then we're going to have Q&A all the time. That means when we're saying something, they're like, hey, what's that? Just raise your hand and shout it, and we're going to figure it out. If you want to be a little bit more polite, you can also use the Drupal Twig tag and just push it there, because Jen is going to keep an eye on it.
And also, if you have questions, if you can go up to the mic, that's even more helpful, and we don't have to repeat it.
And less shouting. Even that's, this is the first part of this will be based on front end, which basically going to mean shouting a lot. Okay, so this is I, many years ago, when I still was hopeful and young and happy and had a lot of hair. This is my whole name, Morten Birch Heide Jørgensen. It's very long, so if I just cut it down to this, this is my original thing, Morten Birch. See that R? It's very easy to misspell. And apparently I got a thing in this community that I was being a little bit of a front-end bitch, because I was bitching and moaning a lot. Why was I bitching and moaning a lot? Well, basically because, well, it was not everything that we did right the right way. So I had to begin to figure out this this kind of a new way of developing. I call it anchor-driven development. And that's basically you get so pissed off about something that you think is so wrong that you want to change it. You can either sit down in the corner and bitch and moan about it, or you can begin to create something about it. That's actually how we ended up having Frontend United, having design camps or front-end camps that was specific only to front-end developers, not back-end developers, not good old-school developers as we had them, always had them in Drupal, but people who know HTML, CSS, JavaScript, want to do something about that. Those people who don't care about your database queries, because caching, that thing, we don't care. I care about beautiful markup, I care about beautiful CSS. That's the whole thing. That was done with pure fucking anger. And it worked out pretty good. Why was I angry? Because of this. This is how a Drupal variable usually look when we put them through the areas of doom. That does not make me happy. So my answer to PHP template has many years been this. It was never built for us. It has never been built for us. It's never been built for a front-end developer. It's a tool that might gonna be good if you are a developer, but it's a pain in the ass to use. So instead of having that, we're gonna add some little bit of a French elegance to this this whole thing. So we have your PHP thing, and we have this French elegance thing, which is a trick. But first of all, I wanna have us all to just say hi to Jen, who's sitting right there. This is her last year at a bad camp. I have been angry for years. I think Jen has been the same. I'm a grown-ass man. I don't cry when code gets committed. I had a session 5 minutes after this. I had to take a walk all around the campus to try to get my own kind of blood down first, because this day, at this point in at bad camp, which is in San Francisco, that same morning, I had the opportunity to sit down and talk with Dries during breakfast. And he was dumb enough to sit down at my table that morning. I talked directly at him for 45 minutes, explained to him how important it was to get this into Drupal Core, getting Twig into Core. And he was like, yeah, I'm listening to you. He did not say anything. 15 minutes later, we are standing watching Dries commit this shit to Core, and we pretty much went, I love you all, kind of way. As you can see here, this is how it looks when you get really, really happy. And that is why later tonight we're going to drink Gin Lamptons. Gin Lampton is a drink that is one part Malibu and one part cranberry juice. It tastes like PHP template. but it looks like Twig, okay? Another thing I'm going to talk about this whole Twig is beginning to create. Angie's talking about the developer experience. I've always been told that front-end developers are not developers. Well, fair enough. If developers have a developer experience on Drupal, well, we're going to create a front-end experience. And why are we going to create that? Well, because those principles that we build on now. We don't more build on the whole thing of just give the theme of that variable and he's going to be happy. Fuck no. We're going to have the idea behind everything now in the front end is we start from nothing. So nothing in the markup or in the CSS that's not necessary is going to be there. We're going to have that clear. We're going to build on use cases. Use cases for the 80%, not from every goddamn case that might going to be invented by someone. Because then we're going to make a tool that nobody want to use, PHP template. Going to provide the right tools so you can actually find yourself. Right now we're using to figure out what kind of variables there's on a page. It's a pain in the ass. Provide those tools for front-end developers so we can find the stuff. Now, visibility. You all know this is Sherlock Holmes, right? Okay, good. I was testing on the Americans. They were like, who's that? I'm like, damn it. Good, I'm in Europe. Visibility, to be able to find what is out in that template. How many here likes to theme menus? For those who's not in the room, there's absolutely nobody raising their hands. Why is menu such a pain in the ass? Because it's just one menu tag. That's it. That menu variable that pumps out all this data. You cannot grab it. You cannot do anything with it. It's kind of like grabbing out in thin air. By having visibility in our theme layer instead, we can find the variables. We can begin to work with them. Consistency. Use the same name. If it's a title, how about we call it a title? If it's content, we could call it content. Don't use title, label, whatever, that's the same naming. This is kind of one of the things we need to work around with, finding the right names. Don't dumb it down. I know all developers think that front-end devs are absolute idiots who cannot understand a simple for loop. How many here who's doing front-end development knows how you do a for loop? How many don't? There was one developer down there trying to be a smartass. I know you. So that's the whole thing. We can actually add all this logic, the front-end logic. We can add that to our templates. So we can stop by having you look into a node. You have that submitted by a person. And you have that string of HTML. You can't do stuff with it. Why is it that way? Well, to make it easy for the theme. That was what I was told 7 years ago. That's not easy. That's dumping crap into my beautiful theme. Stop that. One of the base things we got the last about year and a half, we've been discussing these things again and again and again. What is it that we're going to build upon? And the whole thing is first, we're going to have Drupal Core, aka Stark. That's going to be our base we walk out from. That will be as clean as possible. That means minimal markup, minimum CSS classes, minimal everything. Then you're going to have different. More begin to talk about them as CSS frameworks. So we have two well-known CSS frameworks here. We have good old Bardic over here. By beginning to have, if you begin to build your base theme as a CSS framework instead, we don't have to reinvent the wheel. By having Drupal Core as clean as possible, it's going to be so easy to add that classes and markup that specific framework needs. Then on top of that, you can begin all your themes. Example theme is another thing I'm just going to roll into here. One of the issues we have when we do, how many here do Drupal Core 8 work? Push stuff into core. Okay, see, that's one of the issues because, Joel did. Raise your hand a little bit. One of the things is getting stuff into core is a pain in the ass. Every time you have to push anything in, it's going to be a pain. So what we're going to do instead of having... We're going to have Stark, we're going to have Bardic and Core. We're going to have an example theme. We need to find a good name for that. That's why we're going to go out and drink gin lanterns tonight. The idea behind that is we have the project module called example module, and that is providing all of the little things that you need if you're a developer who does a module. How about we had a theme in Contrib that had all of the stuff that themers needed, and we didn't have to discuss that with the rest of the developer community. I know it sounds like it's kind of crazy, right? Like, we figure out what we want, and then we build it, and we argue about that without arguing with the back-end developers. Yeah. Dream markup is another thing we're trying to build, and the idea behind dream markup is that a lot of us are markup nerds, CSS nerds. We know what we want. The thing is, WebChick told me that a year and a half ago at a shooting range with a shotgun in her hand. she looked at me and said, but Morten, we don't know what you want. Tell us what you want. I'm like, okay, nobody ever told you that wrapping everything into four diffs is a good idea? No, we kind of thought you frontenders wanted that. Like, have you ever heard anybody who wanted to have four diffs with three classes on each? I haven't, but nobody told the developer community how to do it. So that's another issue. Apparently, I've been the only asshole who've been shouting about this, but every time I go out and talk with people, especially frontenders, they're like, holy crap, why can't we just remove this markup? Another thing, the reason I curse this much is because I do frontend, because there's no rules here, and it's just frustrating. So let's see if we can fix that. So that's all about this whole front-end experience. We were talking about what it should be called, TX or FX. I think FX is pretty cool. Kind of you do front-end, you make the stuff being beautiful. So enough of all that, that's the kind of hippie bullshit we're building on here. To get your theme up and running, how many did see Fabian's session today? He talked a lot about like the technical stuff. So instead, what I'm trying to do now, I'm going to show you how I started building a Drupal 8 theme 2 weeks ago, and that was fun, actually. And we're not going to see anything pretty here. We're only going to see pretty markup, and that's going to be even better. So first of all, if you're on GitHub, you can jump in and you can grab my theme. It's called Yggdrasil. And if you don't know what Yggdrasil is, I'm a Dane. That means I got Viking roots. Yggdrasil is a tiny little tree. Nobody from the Nordic countries here, when I say it's a tiny little tree. What is Yggdrasil? The tree of life, exactly. That is where everything good comes from. This is the foundation of everything. So we're not talking about a little twig anymore. We're talking about the tree of life. I mean, we just as well like pump it up a little bit. And if you have got Aegir, we could also got Yggdrasil. Or how did you pronounce it? Jen doesn't want to pronounce it, and she saw the name this morning, Yggdrasil. It's not that hard. It's hard as Aegir. Anyways, the first thing you want to do when you start up your new theme is you want to go down into your settings file. Why do you want to go into settings file? Very, very simple. This, can people see this all the way back? No? Crap. Okay, this says settings, tree debug, true. What that will make is this. This is theme debugging stuff. Let's just get that up a little bit higher. Boom. When you've done that, every time you run anything, you watch that markup, this is what you're going to get. Theme debug, call, theme note, file name suggestion, note article, note 3, note view front page, blah, 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 all of this stuff. All of the files that you normally should go hunt for is now in our Drupal core thing. I personally is very, very glad that they figured this out. It had been a feature in the mothership theme for years. This one, by the way. It is horrible coded, but it was just a way to try it out. So it's these two things. Settings, trick, debug, true. Settings, trick, auto reload, true. But as Fabian over here shouted at me yesterday, there's no need for that one because that one makes it all go. So in your settings file, go search for trick and open that up. Then we're going to look at a little bit of our info file. And it's called a YAML file now. And the big change in this is, well, it's actually not that big. This is our basic of a theme layer. It's going to tell this is the name Yggdrasil. It's a theme. Description is Twig, it's Drupal, it's Love, it's Yggdrasil. Package is call, and it's 8.x. That's how you define your new theme. The next level you're going to see, and here's one of the beautiful things. Up here we have the style sheets. Style sheet definition. We have a style sheet all. Style sheet print and, oops, what's this? Style sheets remove. What do you think that means? We can remove Drupal's bullshit CSS without hacking core, or as the method I call FOAD. I've learned when I wrote an article for the Drupal Watchdog last year that I should not call it fuck off and die. So I call it find object and disable. So what that actually does is, so right here we have user icons.css. I don't want to have that in my theme. I mean, I'm a grown-ass man. I know how to write my CSS. So Drupal, pretty please stop doing that. So style sheet remove, system.theme.css, go away. User icon.css, go away. User icons is up here, reload the page, boom, done, away. It's no more dirty, dirty hack, it's built in. Apparently somebody of the developers listens all things, they're just tired of hearing me bitching and moaning about stuff.
So the question was, can you use a wildcard?
At this point, I don't think so. I found this by coincidence or accident by reading commit logs. I know that the magic module right now in Drupal 7 does that. I'm pretty sure if we push a little bit for that, we could do that. Actually, the best thing could be if you could just clean it all up, but wildcards would be a beautiful idea. Actually, not only submit a patch, because that's always the usual answer, submit a bug about it. Hey, wildcards in style sheets. That's your task for today. Do you know how to create an issue? No? So on Friday, what's happening on Friday, Kotze?
We're having a big sprint where we try our best to welcome new contributors to Drupal Core into the community and into the process. You can come, it's an all-day event, you can come whenever you want. If you're brand new and you don't have IRC or Git or anything like that, there's a workshop in the morning where we can get you all tooled up.
And even if you don't know how to create an issue, because a lot of these things also just finding the error, identifying it, and telling about it, doing that actually saves us a lot of time. So we're going to do that on Friday, or right after this one. So the next thing is like all the old school regions that we used to know and love, and that's just how they work. It looks kind of exactly the same as they used to. And it's the same kind of idea, but now in Twig, you're just going to call them a page.footer instead. So you have a footer that's defined. There we go. And here it is, done. It's simple and it's quick and there's not so much to do about it. So it's the usual way we have always done it. So it's kind of a no-brainer. By the way, if you don't like Twig, if you think PHP template is really, really useful, nice to work with, you don't want to grow up, you can still use PHP template. You just uncomment this line and write engine PHP template. So you're not forced to use Twig. But let me quote John Albin. I don't care if it's there. I'm never going to touch it again. So that's the thing. We have it there still. I wanted to kill it off just completely because I'm angry like that. But we're still going to have it. So if you're not comfortable or don't want to do all the things with your theme, you can just still use it. Anyways, Drupal 8. Where to find your templates now? We talked about this thing. It should be easier to find your templates. I did try first off and ask for, could we have one folder in Drupal Core with all the templates in? That got shut down because of something. I even know something about speed or whatever. Anyways, finding your templates now is, you go into Core, go into modules, go into take the module views, into templates, and hooray, here they are. That's where you're gonna find them. And you just copy them over as we've always done. But when I run into my own theme, you know, I have my themes, and by the way, look at this beautiful thing. I have sites here, I have themes, I have core, I have profiles, I have modules. So we actually have our themes just out in the root where they could live. That's kind of the same thing as dropping it down to site/all. This, in my mind, just makes a little bit more sense and a little bit quicker to understand. And I packed all my files into templates. I don't have to do that, I just like that. And again, I can use subfolders as I wanted to, and you can organize your files the way you want. And here's the other thing, by having everything to be a file now, there's actually gonna be a need to organize your files, else you're just gonna have this whole shit ton of files, it's gonna be impossible for you to work around. Besides that, we're still following the old way of doing. We have an Twig, page, region, block, node, field. It's still the same way that we are kind of using the template file, so it's the same thing. And I'm kind of just gonna run through now a bunch of these fields, different files, so you can see how some of this stuff works. I'm gonna start off with the HTML attributes and body attributes. This is how your Twig file is gonna look like when you open it up the first time. And when I saw this the first time, I'm like, what the fuck is this shit? Because HTML attributes and attributes down here, that's a variable where anything can come through. And I got a little bit, tiny bit frustrated until I figured out how this actually works. So this will just put out old school markup as we have it. Langing, direction, style, classes, blah, blah, blah. The same thing down the body with all of this stuff in. attributes.class instead actually takes this stuff out. See here, I got, I've split it up, HTML attributes, but I'm kind of loading HTML attributes.class before that, and I'm doing the same thing down here with the attributes. What that will happen instead is this little beauty. Doesn't look that much, but we got the, now the class is put where I asked for it. So to begin to add new classes into a template as you want them, that's going to be really, really easy. Now we have separated the stuff, so you don't need to have to battle around this. And that will create your foo and your bar class. So this is kind of just a quick summary. This is how simple it's going to be. So we can even take the attributes.id, a battle plan that was to maybe more remove all the IDs from DrupalCon. That's my personal goal. But you can still have them if you want them. So the next page is the
we've
next
got,
thing.
We've got a question in the back.
So, yeah. Well, so the question is, why would you ever do that? Well, the thing is that we have learned over the years is we don't know what the front end would bring us. If things will change, we want to change different ways of doing. Might you want to do this just quick and dirty because that's a thing you want to do? The whole thing is here that we can do whatever we want. We can split up the elements so Drupal can still load the stuff they want to have in, and you can separate it up. And yes, you will create a maintenance hell for yourself, but that's a choice you're taking. That's not a choice Drupal took for you. That's the whole difference. Was that sufficient?
There's another reason. What we want to try to achieve more with Drupal 8 here is a more separation of presentation and business logic layer. So that means from a business logic, you're just specifying what this thing is, but that doesn't necessarily now you know how it will later be styled. So those classes we are adding here are purely for the presentation logic, and so it makes very much sense to hard code them into the template because they will only apply to this special theme. And if you had a different theme, it might style it completely different. But that is why classes belong in the presentation layer and not in the business logic layer.
Did you hear that, gentleman? In the front-end layer, not in the back-end layer. That's where they belong. Yes, but as a follow-up. Yeah. The point here is that what we want to make sure is that you can do it the way you want it to, that Drupal doesn't demand you as a front-end developer to do things in a certain way. That's the whole kind of thing. That I wouldn't ever put classes in that way, but let's say you have a CSS framework that requires that your body needs to have a certain tag. Well, to get it done quick and dirty, you can just add it in there quickly and get on with it. DrupalCon will ship with only attributes, so it's up to you to split it at the way you want to. A quick one on page HTML.twig is actually, this is just, we still have the old, like, is this a front? Yes, it is. And the page.header. So we have the old school hard-coded variable still in. And page.html.twig still got a lot of hard-coded variables in that we actually want to remove later on. But that's a whole other thing we're going to talk about later. So the variables are still available, so you can do like very, very quickly. Is this the front? If it's the front, I'm the front. If it's not, well, it's not. Done. And just back to this whole thing about the regions. It's the exact same markup that we're using, same way of using it. We just used to call the print footer, print header, so forth. Now we're just calling it a page footer instead, just to repeat this. Another template, the next template, would be the region HTML.twig template, which I still don't understand why we even have that. I think it's a kind of based on an architecture that was built around Drupal 6 and Drupal 7. It's another discussion that we're going to take up on Friday. What kind of template files do we even need? Because if we don't change it now, it will never be changed. So, if you don't even know about code and know what you want, but you kind of know what irritates you, please come and be in our discussions, because this is kind of a valuable thing we need to know. Else it's just going to be my fucked up brain who's going to decide it or what I can push through. Okay, down to our blog HTML.twig file. So if we all remember what we can do with debug, it still gives us the opportunity to figure out what kind of name of our files we're going to need. So let's say I have the menu, good old school menu, but the menu is wrapped in a div class. Instead have a UL, blah, blah, blah thing. I want to have a div wrapped around my my menu. I want to have a nav. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a block dash dash systems menu block HTML trick. Nobody can remember that, but that doesn't really matter because you got the theme hook suggestions to tell you it all the time. So you don't need to go find that name or look for that name and be frustrated about it. For the fun things of it, I'm still doing this attributes class. This is to show this one. If I want to take out the roles and put them specific in here, it's kind of a sub-object, so you can drill into the attributes and grab the roles out of it and then print it all out and have right now the content. Which then will react and you're going to have a nav instead. So this is kind of just the basic things. It's only just to show you this is, we're very close still to how Drupal 7 worked, but we kind of want to move forward with it. And if you even want to go one step further, I still find the having a block called a block, I kind of think is retarded because that's what should I use that class for? That's kind of not how, at least not how I write my CSS. I don't care if you're a block or you're a view. I care how you should look instead. So if you want to remove that right now from that string, because attribute classes is just a string that gets put out, what you can do is actually using this little replace function and call the block and say, well, no, remove the block from my markup. So you can get your markup pretty, pretty, pretty. And to take that, it's, if I have something in a string I want to replace and remove really quick, instead of going and doing a pre-process, adding all that stuff into a template file that you then, template.php file, you then later on have to work around with, Twig has these kind of like small, beautiful things built in where you can just, okay, well, replace the block. If there's a block there, replace it with absolutely nothing. So now you're down to having whatever name it is you want to make your markup cleaner. That's kind of the base thing I'm working out for. How much time did I use so far?
We're half an hour in.
Holy shit, sorry. I'm going to speed up a little bit. So if you're doing it with the node again, it's the same thing always by having trick debug true gives you these things. And this is kind of a huge win when I was doing that because it went so easy for me to actually find this stuff. And the thing is, when I also have my theme file in, tick file, you can find it very, very easy. We're still using the good old hide thing. So hide content comments, hide content links does what hide used to do in the node. And when you want to print it, you just call it content links or content comments. So if you're still using content and as one kind of big block, this is how you're doing it. It's the exact same thing. But to take it kind of a one step further down, if I have the footer of my article, and if anybody makes any jokes about the footer, I have to be in the footer, I'm going to find them with my HTML5 bat and beat them. The footer is the metadata of that article. So I have a footer tag. What I want to create, I want to make sure that this is exactly the markup as I want it. So I can do a date time, node.created time, and then format that thing as I want to. Do the same thing here, because I want to print out 17 September 2013, but I want to make sure that my markup has the right date time. I want to have the comments as a count, and I want to have a break line after that, and then I'm going to have my field tags. This is how you write it. To me, this is so screamingly simple that it almost want to make me cry. If you take it like one step further down, and these are some of this is by the way, this is how we kind of translate now in the future by using the trans tag. If I want to take the note, the author of a note, then I'm going to use note.name. If I want to wrap that into a bunch of icons, I can do that. The same thing with time, note.created time, do what I want with it. To me, this is not. This does not feel dangerous to do. This is just kind of, it's simple, it's easy, it's to work with. Further down here, if I want to figure out, a usual thing would be like figure out how many comments is there, so you can begin to make a little bit of what we call front-end logic. It's not everything that have to be based on that. If that these small things, well, put them out there where we can find them instead. And that will create this kind of thing. So this is the markup I want to have out when I print it out. I need to figure out how to fix the white space, by the way, but that's a whole other issue, so I can make it really, really beautiful. Because what I want to have when I work in the front end, I want to be able to have that feeling of actually just working and writing my markup exactly as I see it, not based on anything Drupal gives me, and then take the variable and the elements that Drupal gives me and then put them out, and they can begin to create these elements. And by the way, also tells me that this is a translation of posted by, so I can find that later on. So now we're kind of getting down there where it usually is a pain point in fields. So let's take for an example the tags, you know, the elements of terms of the taxonomy that prints out on the page. How many modules is it that we today have that does comma separation or put an icon in, all kinds of different stuff? What all they do with these modules is they modify your markup to take your tags and do something with it. So let's say I get an assignment from a client and they give me this one. I want to know the amount of tags there is. I want to have the first of them being comma separated, but the second term should be in italic or some dumb shit that some designer figured out that he wanted to do. And you're just kind of like, fuck, how am I going to do this? And by the way, it has to end with a dot. Commas in between have to end with a dot. If it doesn't do that, it's a catastrophe. Because we know how designers are, right? Everything that's not exactly how they said is kind of the end of the world. Am I the only one who works with designers that way? Because when I don't do front end, I do design, and believe me, I turn up the heat on every fucking little detail. I'm a bitch, because that's almost my last name. So let's look at this. Oh my, this looks interesting. What I do here is I do a for loop, for delta item and items. This is just a basic loop. I'm still not really sure what delta does. I don't know, can it be called anything else?
It's like your counter, like 1, 2, 3, 4.
Ah, see, they are clever. I don't know this stuff, but I can still use it without breaking anything. So let's first look at this, for delta. Okay, if you have something, well, give me a span with a class where I cycle through even and odd and use that delta thing that apparently counts, and give me a count dash the number of loops we're in so I can get a count dash one, count dash two, count dash three class. So this would be kind of basic stuff we want to put out. If you're the first loop, figure out if should I be called tags or tags. So if I only have one tag, I want to have the line to say one tag. If I have two tags, there should be an S on it. I mean, English is not my first language, but having two tag is wrong, right? But two tags is right. This is where we begin to talk about having front-end logic. Just this small shit you know you need to just fix and check out, and you don't want to write a module to figure that out. I mean, that's retarded. And there's no reason to, you have to, you know, walk down to the dungeon where all your developers are sitting and doing evil stuff to your code, and you have to ask them about it, and you have to beg for them and bring them coffee and stuff, because else the designer go nuts. Now we can fix it ourselves. So after that, well, you know, I want to, if this is the second loop, if loop index equals 2, I want to add a special class terms dash dash underline to that item. And if it's the last loop, I want to add the dot. If it's not any of these things, well, just print the item, you know, with the comma in. This gives us this kind of markup. This is not a module gentleman who did that. This is the Twig file who did that. Very, very simple. It took me about 4 to 5 minutes to figure that out by looking at the documentation, doing this, and be like, holy crap. Then I looked at this markup and became a little bit annoyed, because why do I have span tags around it? I mean, hey, I'm a grown-ass man. I can minimize my markup, because less markup is better markup, at least in my world. So I don't want to have this. I want to have all these combined in here. But right now, this is just an item. So how do we do that? I'm glad, Morten, you asked that question. How do we do that? Fabian over here has not yet delivered his promise of giving me absolute drillability. So right now, how you call these things is called in by an item, and then its key. So here I have the item, the href, which is the link. And I have my item, the title over here, and then I have a class I create over here. So that gives me this thing instead. I have an even count one, even count two, even count three instead. So now I'm beginning to have my markup as simple as absolutely possible. And the trick I actually, one of the tricks I'm doing here is I'm setting a class that I'm defining first, and I ask it to cycle through. So every time we do a loop, cycle through it and give me also the count in it, end set. So set class, end set. It's kind of predefine a variable right now, right here, because I need that. And then just push it down, and then you're gonna have your straight up markup as I wanted to write it, not that anybody else decided I should write. So if I wanna do something dumb with this, I can go that way. And this is, so right now what we are working on is instead of you going ul item href, we're going to go to item.href instead, so we're going to have the same notation, because one of the things that drove us not in PHP template were that whole, you have an, is this an array, is this an object, how is this actually working? Is absolutely nobody excited about this? I mean, come on. This is the markup we're putting out, goddammit. This is a real file, it's a real text file that I just created, and I did absolutely uber control over Drupal's markup. I was dancing in my apartment last week when I did this. I was like, holy fuck, finally I get this control. And you're just sitting there and looking. The same thing with you when you try to explain to people yesterday what we can do. Like, don't you get it? This is theme control to the max. It is no more bullshit.
I'll just add one more quick thing before we go on.
Yeah.
The one tag, multiple tags, for the developers in the audience, you can also use the trans block and do, that's like the equivalent, you can do the equivalent to format plural. And that way it's all translated and nice.
I don't even know what he says.
The trans tag.
Ah, the yeah. Trans tag, okay.
Yeah, anyway, carry on.
It was more that plural thing, what's that?
It just makes, when you actually have to translate it, it makes it easier.
Yeah, because you might have one item, but several items.
Yes.
One versus many. One, two, many. Nah, sorry for that. Okay, here's a sexy thing. We all know that in Drupal land, we have a block. In Twig land, we also have a block. We are might going to call these Twig blocks, but that's only when we talk about them.
Not the same block,
what?
It's not the same.
This is not the same as a block in Drupal. This is a Twig block, but we call it this way. What is that, you ask? Well, imagine this. We have a page HTML.twig thing, and I know I'm going to shift my header on certain pages because client asked for it, and I don't want to write conditional statements and stuff and just make my markup quicker and easier to work with. So I say if block foo, end block, and that's kind of where my, do people understand this is a pseudo markup? So this is kind of where I start my if block, and this is kind of where I end it. If you don't, shout out. And I want to do this. When I'm on the front page, this should be pink and have stuff upon it. Again, we look into the theme hook suggestions. Hooray. Page dash dash fronts. Okay. then what I'm going to do is, inside of my page HTML, the Twig file, I'm going to say, hey, make me a header block. And then I ask it to change me if I'm on the front page. Then on the name that says page dash dash fronts html.twig that everybody now remembers that we just got from a debug tool, I'm gonna do an extend themes Yggdrasil template page html twig. So if I'm on the page html twig, I'm kind of extending this. So if you're here, use this template. So the example you all saw yesterday where they just wrote page html.twig, doesn't work out. That cost me a couple of hours to figure that out. I was kind of getting a hissy fit on Fabian a couple of days ago because it was not working. He fixed it immediately. I'm always kind of impressed when dev does that. So if it's the header block, you know, call out and say, I'm on the front page. Simple as that. I'm now on a node 3. Change me if I'm on the front page. Boom. Done. One template. No more. We want to change elements that way. It's just how I do it. It's simple as fuck. So to take it up again, page front, you create that Twig file, and you can just extend that element and change it. That means that we can actually take that html.html.twig file, combine that with page.html.twig, take these two files, combine them within each other, and remove yet another of these template files we got. So we can actually begin to make our theme layer even more simple. As one of the last things, I'm just going to show a little trigger. Trick I did with Twig in views. Try to say that five times after two Jane Lamptons. What I did before with that set classes is I now want to take a view row that gets pushed every time we call a view, and recreate the classes it does. It gives me, but give them other names, because the framework I'm using requires that. It doesn't have first and last class. It's called them the first or the last. It have odd and even, and it had a count dash something. That's kind of the same thing that, that Views today creates out. So I can do the whole same thing in the theme layer instead. I don't have to rely on these things that Drupal puts out. So I have the count loop.index. It just counts the amount every time I do a loop, counts one on it. Even and odd, the same thing. If it's the first loop, use the first as a class. If the second loop, use the last as a count. And then actually, just because I'm a front markup nerd, replace all the new lines with nothing, just because I could. And I got irritated when I looked at my markup. And that creates this. Boom, done, finish. No more, no less. That's how I created, that's how you rechange Drupal's markup out of the box without doing anything else. To me, this is pretty beautiful. So again, nobody recognizes how epic this is. Nobody. Have to drag it out of them. The thing about white spaces, I was looking at a lot of Jen had done. I was kind of looking around and saw Jen had done a theme a couple of months ago and trying to figure it out. And they got this minus all over and figured, I don't know what that is. That's how to remove white space. So if you have, you know, a B tag with a foo in, and you kind of want to remove the white space on that side, you can just do it. You ask it to remove that, and same thing with spaceless. Kind of remove all the white space. I think that's pretty sweet, actually. That's kind of the, those small little things just makes my life easier, and I get a little bit happy about that. Another thing, we talked about translate. So if you have a string, goes last check, time ago, something, we can use just a T function that we call, and then we translate time to time. Nobody wanna do this. So a patch we got in 3 weeks ago, about 3 weeks ago, makes this possible instead. You just do trans, and trans, and then you put the line in, done. No more of this crap that nobody, I hate this, by the way. I hate it with a passion. Like, why is it done this way? God fucking damn it. This makes sense. Again, that's the beauty of this. It's just kind of small things, it just makes sense. Question in the back.
They're working on it.
That's going to be actually the answer to 90% of all your questions. Either they're working on it, or you should come to the code sprint on Friday.
It's possible.
Yeah. Another thing when we were talking about this whole what we were going to do in the theme layer and the front-end experience is what I call divide and conquer. Because front-end development is basically three different things. You know, it's CSS. There's some HTML. And we got some JavaScript. That's kind of the three different things. What I don't get is why these are so integrated into each other. That's kind of retarded. So things we're kind of working on now is actually to us from the I do CSS and markup thing, trying to figure out how we can make this also a better experience for the JavaScript community so we don't begin to meddle things around. So if you have any JavaScript nerds in the room, we really want to play with you to figure out how we also can make your experience better. And one of the things is that we have in the new guidelines for Drupal 8's class naming for CSS is we're going to use, you know, every time we have a class that's going to be used by JavaScript that JavaScript needs, we're going to have a JS dash, you know, whatever it's going to call. What we're beginning to talk about now is we're using data attributes instead. So we can remove everything that is, any classes that's not used to make stuff pretty with CSS. Is going to be removed. So if you have classes that you use for your JavaScript, remove that out and put them in data attributes instead so we can have complete separation of it. It's kind of a thing we're getting traction on right now. A thing I hope for is getting some measurements so we can figure out if this is quicker or slower. And here's, by the way, one of the latest things. Is this is our Twig team, by the way. Katsa, what are you? Are you a dev? Developer? Yeah, kind of. So we have a developer, a front-end developer, very much a developer. Joel,
front end.
Front end. Steve Oliver,
developer.
And hungover. The David Meister,
developer.
Chicks,
super developer.
So we threw him out, by the way. Mark Carver, which front end, and me, who is
front end.
Ah, thank you. So this is the whole team that is bringing you all of these goodies. What do you think we need? That was actually not the answer. That was not the correct answer.
I mean, yeah, you can buy us some Jen Lamptons, but we need your help.
So
we need more of you. Yeah.
Here's the thing. I've been bitching on John Orban for years for this stuff. And I don't know how he did it, but he sneaked out and pushed me in front of him. So apparently now I'm the escape goat. That is fine with me, because I have no objection of being a dictator who decides how everything is going to be. I would really like to discuss this with a little bit with other people, how we could do this front-end thing. So it's kind of a thing that even that you don't know what to do or how to do it, you know, come in and ask the question, all the dumb questions right now. Hey, how can I do this, this, and that? How can we rebuild these things the right way? It's really important we get the opinion now instead of 6 months after Drupal 8 have shipped, which is going to be
too late.
So tomorrow we're going to have a buff. I can't remember where we put it. Somewhere. Look at the buff schedule. We're going to have a buff. We're trying to plan this a little bit more, because we're going to be here this weekend. Then a bunch of us is going to be at Bad Camp in about 3 weeks. And I'm going to be in Vienna, and I'm going to be in Oslo as well. I'm going to run sprints of getting more people into this, because this is kind of where, and I've been preaching this for years, this is kind of the time where we have an excuse, because you know, Fabian created this beautiful framework, and to make this work, we need to go through every template, every inch of Drupal's markup structure, how Drupal does stuff. So this is a one-in-a-chance lifetime to actually change all these things that we didn't like around the markup. This is when we can actually tell the web chicks of Drupal what is it that we want, instead of coming 6 years later and bitching and moaning. It's simple. I mean, as honestly as I see it, I've been living on Drupal for the last 6 years. I'm not rich, but it made me enough to travel the world and have fun. I owe this back to the developer community, to be straight up honest. I owe this to all our developers who's doing this amazing thing about building this Drupal thing. It's not my fault they're too dumb to understand the beautiful front end. I have to help them with that. But I'm not the only one who owe this to the developer community. Every goddamn front ender in this room who is making a living by Drupal owes this back to this community. That's at least how I see it. So you can either buy us Jen Lamptons, hope you're not getting too hungover, or step the fuck up to the plate and come and help. I'm not asking nicely anymore. I'm demanding it from you, actually. Because, hey, this is a community. This is what makes a community great. You bring something in. Even those, how many here doesn't even know a PHP? Good. There was one. He's probably lying. How many here want to see this actually happen all over? Good. We now have a code sprint on Friday. I'm beating on this drum again and again and again. Quick resources. twig.central/docs/templates is kind of where you get all the documentation. github.com/mortendk/yggdrasil is where my beautiful, beautiful theme that doesn't do shit that's pretty, but the markup is so pretty, so beautiful. And of course, on our RSC thing, we have Drupal-Twig, which is where all the cool kids hang out. Come in and join. Just hang around, be there. Help us. You know, it's also a thing about actually having a communication going. So, hey, how should we do this? Does this make sense? Can you look at that issue? These kind of things. I wrote the buff in. Thursday, 2:15 in the Azure room. I have absolutely no idea where that is, but that's where we're going to take this discussion. It's next. We planned this, by the way. It's next door. No, so here's the thing. We need to figure out what people actually want. And even if you don't, I can't commit to doing this code. I have no idea how to do it. We still need you. If you're a badass developer who's tired of hearing your front-end devs bitch and moan on a daily basis, we need you too.
That was pretty much what got me into this.
The code sprint, what we're going to discuss in my side is going to be markup, CSS, JavaScript, all the non-programmer thing, all the soft things. You know, I had one developer sitting there today in the code room. He was like, Morten, can you help me with this? Because I don't understand CSS. how hard is it to understand CSS? You just need to know that you have, every browser does it a little bit different. You have 200 to 300 different kind of things that can look at that, that also does a little bit different. And you just learn by heart. You know, there's no documentation for this. How hard, why is that so hard? I still don't get it. We just, yeah, it's just like Drupal. So that was the kind of rundown of how the Twig theme thingy works right now. Any questions on that? Because IDs is the devil. No, there's actually, here's a very good reason for it. When you use an ID, the way that we measure, so let's say you have, you say your ID page, you put a class in that's green, your background color green. I want to override that later on. If it's an ID, I can't override it with another class. So I need to add something over that. That is when I go in to have to add important. That's when big CSS frameworks begin to be really, really complicated to handle out. So the reason to remove the ID is, well, one thing is that the CSS is going to be easier to maintain. Also that if you have an element on a page, let's say a block that got an ID on it, but that block gets called twice because we never know what our site builder is going to throw in. We suddenly have two IDs on a page. That's not allowed. So that's simply one of the, that's the two. The thing about not allowed, I'm actually not so much caring about. I have it that I don't want to use important in my CSS. I want to make sure my CSS get built up the right way. And if you begin to look into the more modern ways of writing CSS, BEM and SMAX, and begin to see how the structure and how complicated it kind of begins to be when you're building really, really, really big frameworks, that's when you figure out that IDs are suddenly the devil. By the way, I can announce that page.html.twig file do not have any more IDs inside of it, because we sneaked the fucking patch in 3 weeks ago. And check this out, by the way. This is good. Here's the patch to go like this. So clean up HTML.html twig. What is this? What is it about? Well, we don't want to have all these dumb classes into it. Here's how you're going to get a patch in. Oh, yeah, actually here's the, where's my screenshot? So I created this patch. What I do is I remove the from the body tag those classes that says one sidebar, two sidebar, sidebar left, sidebar right. I have to provide this. Screenshots of stock so the developers can see I have not changed anything in the layout. That's what they require. Then at some point, you're going to say, hey, Kotzer, can you look at this for me? Then you're going to get stuff like this, blah, 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 blah.
That's web check.
That's actually a web check, yeah. So here's the thing we're doing here is we're removing these things. Just, and here's me bitching back at why I want to have this ready to be committed. It's been ready to be committed, what, 6 times so far? And every time somebody finds another little error. And that's why we need more people inside of the issue queue, because if it's only me and Kotzer and John Lewis who's figuring this stuff out, you're going to live with that for the rest of your Drupal 8 life. And we kind of want to figure it out before instead of after. And that's kind of, I know it's kind of sound dumb to actually do our homework the right way, but that's kind of a thing we need. And I am, by the way, helping to get this thing into Drupal core, because that will remove one of the other things of saying that all Drupal sites have a left and right class. Anyways, that's just a small little thing. Any other questions?
The question is like, is Twig like Jinja for Python? The answer is kind of. The syntax is very, very similar. And I believe it was originally inspired from it.
And some differences?
I'm not sure. We didn't invent Twig or anything. We're kind of new to it. Not me personally, but we basically determined that it was the best fit for Drupal. And we're sort of, the possibilities are so great that we're really only starting to learn all the possibilities and what we can do with it. So I don't know, I'm sure someone's done a blog post, but I don't have that knowledge.
Is anybody at all excited about that besides of me and Jen, who's kind of one around in little circles? Ah. I mean, because if I've been leading this battle for 6 years and trying to get front-end devs through the room, and we've been using a year and a half so far to get this in, and the reaction was, bah, I would be a little bit sad. All right. So yesterday we got a, should we take the break now, or should we take the interesting quiz? So yesterday we got a really interesting question from an unknown person that had a lot of Drupal 7 themes, and he needed to upgrade them. We went into the code sprint yesterday, and we coded a little thing that you can use. Forrest, can you show us the thing you coded yesterday?
Yeah, it wasn't a day.
All right. So, thank you for listening to me not going completely nuts over this, and thank you for actually showing up. I look forward to see each and one of you, all of you who raised your hand. It was a tiny bit excited that coming in and help, and see you all on the code sprint, all the buff actually. So, Forrest, take it away.
Also, after our little demo here, we're going to give you guys a break so you can walk around, get a coffee, whatever, and come back for more goodies.
Okay. Suppose you're now you're going to want me to switch the text too.
Yep.
Okay. Let's see. Is that going to work better for people? Oh, great. I was wondering about that, but then I also wanted to have a contrast. So what I have is I've got a D7 install and a D8 install running here. Actually, we really don't need this one that much. So that's going to be fine. And then we're going to grab this that's there, just making sure everyone's there. Great. And let's do this. Okay. So this is a quick demo. My name is Forrest Mars, and I'm a New York-based developer, among other number of hats I wear. And I was giving some thought to a particular problem in Drupal. That if everyone can read this quote, it's that all templating languages eventually evolve to become Turing complete. And this is essentially what had happened with PHP template, where anything became possible in the theme layer and you can do anything. So then we ripped that out and we now have Twig, which is this amazing, I mean, everyone I think was in the session yesterday and people have been looking into it, it's amazing. So what is the problem? Like, this is, sounds really great. So, but there was a particular problem that I was wrestling with my team in New York, and it can be expressed in this quote, which some of you may be familiar with, that was originally used to describe using regular expressions to solve a problem. And it's that some people, when faced with a problem, say, I know, I'll just use regular expressions for this. Now they have to, so it's the same thing. Some people, when faced with an unruly theme layer, say, I know, I'll just use Twig for this. Now you have two problems. But what are the problems, right? Well, the first problem is simply that you have a new language to learn. And what I've kind of noticed in the community is it seems like the pain is not really learning the new language so much as unlearning the old language. And everything you did learn, like it's as if we had this investment in this kind of like somewhat horrible system, but we were really used to it and it worked for us, but now we have to unlearn it. But that's only one problem. There's another problem that seems to be the really pressing one, and that's that if any of you have been developing for a while or work at companies have been developing for a while and have many clients and many installations and many sites, you know that, I mean, if you're in Fabian's amazing talk earlier today, learning Twig and how to use it doesn't seem to be a big problem. And you could apply this to all of the sites that you maintain, that you have in 7, like if you have a huge client footprint or you're with an enterprise company that has a lot of sites, or you just really don't want to spend all of your time converting all of those themes in Drupal 7 to Drupal 8. I mean, you have to, you know, once you learn the system, you still have to apply that knowledge, and you're faced with the pain of upgrading all of your sites. And it's just annoying, right? And everyone's doing the same thing, right? All of you are out there converting code constructs in 7 to the equivalent versions in 8, and every, you know, we're all typing the same keystrokes, right? Like, why are we doing this? Is this a good model for open source development? Isn't this something that we could try to apply some kind of computational methods to and automate? So this is the problems that we are wrestling with. And so we've created this little module. It was not, I have to correct it, it was not created yesterday. It was not done in a code sprint, and it was certainly not done in a couple hours, because it's a module that actually goes through all of your Drupal themes, your existing Drupal themes that you have installed on a Drupal 7 site, and it lexes over them. It does not, you don't really need a parser to do this kind of stuff, and plus, unless you're Febian, who I think might be in the back row there, you really probably are not going to be ready to write one, whether it's an abstract parser or just looking at the concrete syntax. But just tokenizing all of the code in a 7 template, it really gets you enough to then, and if you look at the module, you'll see we have a rule set there, and it's basically just one of the files in there is a long set of the rule mappings. So what I've got here is, I've got a D7 install running here, and I'm just kind of SSH'd into it locally, and then here we have a D8 is running right alongside of it. This is the Alpha 3, this isn't the latest build, so it's just an Alpha 3, and then if I go, I see that I'm on my D8 install here, and I've got, there's D7 is just running alongside it. And so here's D8, and it's got just the themes that comes in the alpha, right? And you've got Bartik and 7 sitting there. And then over here on D7, I have a few themes installed. I've got Bartik, Basic, Fusion, Blueprint, I've got a whole bunch of them. The module is called Twigifier. There's two sandboxes, because one kind of like gives you the high level of what has to be done to convert your themes, and then one kind of, this was originally envisioned, and then one is the engine that does the work automatically. Right now, they're effectively just the same module, so I'm gonna consolidate them into a single namespace. And so, if we are in our D7 install, let's just run a drush PML.
And stop. If you want to know more, come back after the coffee break.
We're gonna do the demo after the break? Perfect. So we'll actually demo it working on a theme. I did play around with converting Mothership last night, so we'll see everyone after the coffee break.
Yeah, come back for the thrilling conclusion.
Oh, what a cliffhanger. What a cliffhanger.
So come back in 10 minutes. 2:15.
Yeah, there is. We just didn't want people to miss it, and we weren't sure of timing.
Because
the point.
Yeah.
The point is, you don't get any more coffee if you go to 8.
Yeah.
Fundamental. And we thought it was a good point.
Yeah. Cliffhanger. We get a cliffhanger.
Cliffhanger.
Thank you.
So Jen, like that, your thought of like going around to help people, what, like, are we gonna ask them like if they have practical questions or something here? Okay. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Right. catch. Okay, we're done. I was an advocate of the model, you know, like this whole thing of like punting and stuff, and anyone can contrib and not knowing what's going to happen. I was like, look, just put the APIs in core and like contribute all the
APIs. Well, that's what they've been doing, right?
Right.
Like all
right.
Of
right. Because but
now,
but
by
yeah, only because we run out of time. Because if you look at like the kind of roadmap for any relationship or any work, it's always like we're going to do this into the API, and then we're going to do this integration, and then the bottom thing is like and there's UI.
Right.
So and that's something happens with the dates and the phrases.
Yeah,
the UI is like.
And it's like thing I'm a field. So I'm actually like,
exactly.
Need the UI for fields. And then I'll shift that one. I mean, how crazy would that be? Like, and then, like, the base of the word is
right?
But it would be fields to the UI. Like, what? No, we need that. Don't do that.
I know this is
the thing.
Code Monkey thing reminds me of that, of the song Kitten Killers did at Copenhagen.
That's actually the one that did my song visually.
Yeah.
He has also, the just came out with a comic book,
oh, nice.
Code Monkey Saves the World.
Yeah. It's great. I listen to that recording every once in a while, because I recorded it.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool.
Yeah,
I would love to hear it. Is this people that are coming back?
Yeah.
It's like almost 20 after.
Yeah. It's,
No. What are you talking about?
Scott, you want to start? You want to ready? No? No, we're waiting. We're still waiting?
Oh.
We
can start. Yeah, we can start.
Okay. I think people have plenty of time to have gotten their coffee and got back in, not gotten sidetracked on the hallway conversations. So, feels oddly, weirdly like a television show with some cliffhanger, and everyone was left like, will the module work? Will the output be craptaculous? For those of you just joining us, the recap is that we've got a Drupal 7 install here, and it's just vanilla Drupal 7 running alongside vanilla 8 alpha 3, and Twigify module is pretty much like the only module installed on 7. But there's a whole bunch of themes installed. So there we go. We see that Twigify is just download and enabled. And Twigify currently runs as a Drush extension. I definitely want to get it into the UI so you can just like go to a page on your site and just click, 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 and then it like outputs like there's your 8 theme, and you just like put that on your, you know, as an exportable, and you just put it on your 8 site. Currently it runs as a Drush command extension. So if I just were to type, as simple as that, as this is going to be Drush Twigify. It's going to ask me a couple questions here. I'm sure there is. I guess everybody can read that. There is one major downside to using Twigify to automatically convert your Drupal themes from PHP template to Twig, and that is you're going to have to buy some replacement Y keys for your laptops. Because pretty much the process consists of, for, on the user side, of pressing the Y key repeatedly. So, so before we begin, you just want to make sure what you need. You want to know what you're going to call your new theme. You want to know the you have the source theme that you want to convert installed on your Drupal 7 site. It has to be installed, doesn't have to be enabled. And then you want to know the Unix root path. That's the Unix root path, not the Windows root path, to where you want the converted theme to be saved to, which I don't think I actually know. So, but I'm going to press Y anyway. The first thing it does is it scans for all the themes that are installed on your site. There's a, I'm like to see it, there's a feature request, obviously, to be able to scan your entire site and do modules to like convert all the templates and things inside of a module. So, I see Mothership is installed here, but I'm not feeling that brave. So I think what we'll do is let's go, we actually had a request to do Blue Marine, and so.
that was me, by the way.
And so the first thing it says, you know, what do you want to call your new theme? So we're going to call it Blue Marine Ocho. And sure, that's quite acceptable. So so the next thing it's going to do, it's going to create a new theme folder for your Drupal 8 theme, and it'll create wherever you want it to create it. And if you don't know, it's going to give you some helpful information to say yes. So obviously we know that in Drupal 8, finally themes actually go in the themes folder. Like, who would have thought? We would finally fix that. And let's see, so I'm going to actually switch over here and just grab my current working path. And just on my Drupal 8. So I just copied the working path for my Drupal 8, and then of course I'm going to put it in the themes directory. That makes sense. So it's going to ask me, it's kind of misleading, it's, do you want to create an info file? So what it's going to do now is it's going to create the YAML file for your theme, and sure, I want to do that. And so it just created it just like that, so I'm going to make a new YAML file for my new Drupal 8 theme based on Blue Marine. And do I want to remove the old file? So it's not removing it, obviously, from your 7 theme. It's just it's copied alongside of it, and you don't need it. So if you wanted to leave it there, like take a look at it and compare like what the info file, old info file looks like side by side, you can leave it there. But we don't really need it, so we're going to remove it. So the next thing it does is it processes all the tpls. It's going to look for all the tpls it can find, and it's going to iterate over them interactively and ask you if you want to process them. And so I think let's do all, yeah, we'll just do block, box, there's a typo in my code, sorry. We need a space in there so you can read it. Do you want to twigify the comment TPL? Yes, and obviously node and page. So, and the next thing it does, it finds the functions, right? So here's all the theme functions and pre-processes, and do you want to process that batch? Those are batch processed. And then it finds, of course, your template PHP, and do we want to convert that to the theme file, which we use in 8, absolutely. And then do we want to, same thing, do we want to remove the template PHP, which just corrupt, so we get rid of it unless you want to look at it. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to just run through this real quick again in case anybody missed anything. Here we go. Take a second for it to fire. So we're going to, there we go, and we're going to pick Blue Marine again, and our new name for the theme, we're going to call it Blue Marine, because I misspoke. I said Ocho, but I typed 8, so it's actually Ocho. There we go, and don't need the information. Definitely don't need that. There we go, in the theme, so those of you that missed it the first time can see what we're doing here, and we'll create the theme info file, remove the old file. I'm gonna skip the block template, because block ID HTML is really not needed, and it just creates some warnings. So box though, and comment, and all the good node and page, obviously. And process all the functions, create the theme file, get rid of the template PHP. And so what it's done now, it actually just took the Blue Marine theme, and Alexa ran over it, and all of the nice little tokens that it recognizes, it just converted over and it packaged all that up. And you know, the time it takes to do this, so instead of you spending an afternoon or a weekend or a couple hours or however long it takes you to convert the theme, depending on like your level of scaffolding and the complexity of the theme, which is the real problem, you know, it takes, you know, a few minutes and, you know, 99 cents to replace your Y key. So now if we go to our Drupal 8 install, there's our 7 install with all the themes, and then here's our Drupal 8 alpha. So what we're going to have to do first is we're going to run over here and make a little side trip, because we do have to clear the theme registry or we're going to get some pink output, presumably. So, and then after doing that, did that come back? Yeah, I'm just coming back. I'm going to refresh the page. So we had Bartik in 7, so now we should have a new theme here, and there we go. So we have a couple themes that are disabled there on our 8 site, and one is Blue Marine Ocho, and in theory, remember this is a demo, we can enable and set default. I'm going to click that right now, and let's go, somebody cross their fingers here, and let's see that, so comes back, things look pretty good, no errors. Let's see what the homepage looks like. And what we have here is Blue Marine running in plate. Yeah. And we can use it. I mean, it's ready to go. We put, you know, can add a new block, la la la, you know, and this is a new block. Put that in the we can assign it. Let's see. La, la, la. There we go. Let's just put it in the footer so we can see it. There we go, and lo and behold, we should have down here, everyone can see. I mean, it's just Blue Marine running on 8, you know, and like I said, you know, go out and buy some Y keys and you do your theme conversion. So that's that. It's not really done. I mean, there's a whole roadmap, you know, obviously there's an issue queue. I keep meaning to apply for full project access, you know, but right now it's just in the sandbox, so at some point I am actually going to, like, yes, get the thing promoted so you can just find it in the namespace and not have to, like, have the sandbox URL, but it's real easy to find on Google, you know, and I obviously use the Google search, not the DO search. The main thing that I really want to add here, you know, there's a lot of, like, cleanup stuff that makes the module nicer, and so please jump on the issue queue and, you know, do some feature requests, obviously, if you find bugs. What I really want to, and we could discuss this at the BOF tomorrow, is to have an API for you to be able to plug in additional rule sets for conversions. And this is going to be really important for converting base themes, right? Because ultimately, we want to be able to convert all derivative themes, whether it's Omega or Zen or Mothership or any of them, should be able to convert this easily. Right now, of course, this doesn't work because the rule set, you know, is not smart enough. But I am not going to write the tokenized rule sets for every single theme on Drupal.org. Sorry. But it seems to me it makes a lot more sense if the base theme providers, if Twigify just provides the API, then base theme maintainers can then look at the output. So what it does, and so just so you know, Twigify does, it's not always 100%, obviously. So depending on how close your theming stays to, you know, coding standards, the better it's going to, you get a little more off the rails or highly custom. What's going to happen is it's going to run into tokens it doesn't know, and so it's going to wrap those in a Twig comment, and hopefully in the next release, it's then going to give you a little report either through Drush or on the page when you use it, and it's going to say, these are how many little bits of code we couldn't convert, you know, and they're wrapped in comment tags, so they're still in there, and they're wrapped in comment tags, and you get a report. And if you think about it, this is really, really nice to do some kind of auditing, especially if you have, like, a suite of sites, or your company has a lot of sites, and you just don't even know, like, what the cost of conversion is going to be. You can actually, you'll be able to use this as an auditing tool, so you can get a sense of, oh, yeah, well, we've got 17 things we need to convert over in this theme, and we've got so many sites, and we've got a nice report. And then, moreover, you can look at that output, and especially if you're a base theme maintainer, and say, well, these rules are really easy, you know, easy to come up with for our particular base theme. And so if we can get an API into Twigify that allows you to just plug in rule sets, you're just adding to the rules include file, just adding onto that, then we should be able to, by the time Drupal 8 is released, easily have a Twigify running so that we'll be able to do full-on theme conversions for every distributed, every derivative theme for base themes. So that's the demo.
And yes, I am responsible for, we now have Blue Marine in Drupal 8, just to make it very clear. It's not evil developer, it's just me being perverted.
So the trim white space operator works exactly like the PHP ltrim or rtrim function. So if you're putting like a minus, then it will trim all white space before and all white space after. It won't trim white space in between, but if you need that, you can always push your content to a filter, and with that filter you can, for example, replace double spaces with something else.
And there was another question, maybe Potsdam Paul, if you can come up. I'm not quite understanding it. It's about replacing the block class, so maybe come up to the mic, or you can come talk to us later. And then the other question was about, is there some kind of debug output for variables to see like the available attributes, for example, KPR or DPM, like from the devel module? And the answer is yes, but we're working on something better. Twig does come with a dump function, which will dump all the variables, but it also kind of gives you a whole mess of stuff that you don't really need. So we would really like to have a nice variable inspector in core. But we need help to do it. We're already trying to do so much. So
there's a little trick you can do at the moment. As soon as you enable the trick debug equals true in your settings PHP, you have this dump function available. You just print dump like you would print any variable. And then there's a reserved keyword, which is called underscore context, which is kind of like where every variable is stored within a trick template internally, and then you can just do a pipe and pipe it through keys, and then you know which variable names are available. So if something like a contrib module added some things to it and it's not in the documentation of your template, you can have underscore context pipe keys, and then you just get the array keys, so to speak.
Cool trick. And I mean, the nice thing about Twig too is it's very extensible and flexible. So even if we're not able to get this awesome variable inspector into core, it's still very, very possible to do in contrib, for example, in the devel module. So thanks for the questions, and send in some more. You can even send them in the Drupal Twig IRC. How are you doing, Jen?
I'm getting closer.
All right.
I'm trying to make it so you guys can see code. How is it in the back? Are you able to see this text, or do you need it bigger? Bigger. How's that? Bigger? Is that good? Okay. All right, so how many of you are contrib module maintainers? A few. Have any of you started trying to upgrade your modules to Drupal 8 yet? One. Okay, so you might know more than I do. So if you see me doing something stupid, feel free to correct me. I have not actually done a lot of upgrading my modules to Drupal 8 yet. This is the first one. Stuff will probably change between, you know, maybe change between this morning and now, so don't take this as law here. But you can get my code. What I've done so far, this module that we're going to do a quick run through of updating is called On the Web. You can get it on Drupal.org. If you dig deep into the version control section here, there is an 8.x section of code. So if you want to look at it later, it's there. Again, it's not guaranteed to be right, but it's here. So what I'd like to do is go through the process of upgrading a module from Drupal 7 to Drupal 8. This is a really simple module. All it does is provide a block. So hopefully the module upgrade part won't be too scary. What I want to focus on is how to take the theme functions that I provided in the Drupal 7 version of my module and turn them into the Twig templates that I need to provide for my Drupal 8 version of the module. There's a couple of bad practices that I adopted in Drupal 7 because I copied all the other contrib module maintainers who all did exactly the same thing. And we're going to go through the process of cleaning those up in the upgrade as well. So you can see kind of the right way to do things in Drupal 8 with your Twig templates. Again, writing code live against a system that I don't know very well might not go very well. So bear with me, but we'll see. All right. So I'm going to start off here. I've got my Drupal 7 module. Again, all it does is provide a block. The concept here is that it's got social media icons, right? So Facebook, Twitter, whatever, you want these things on your site. This is one of these things where we built custom blocks over and over again for every single site. And then I was like, there should be a module for that. So now there is. So the block in the real world has a configuration form that lets you plug in your URLs to your Facebook page and your YouTube page. We're skipping all that just for brevity here, and I'm just going to hard code, so all these links will link to Google, which will be fun, but at least you'll get to see how this works. So on my Drupal 8 site, I currently don't have the module installed yet, so I'm going to go ahead and create the Drupal 8 module based on the Drupal 7 module. So for starters, we have a YAML file instead of an info file. All it has very similar information as the Drupal 7's info file, the name of the module, what type of extension it is for Drupal here. It's a module, the description for the module, and the version of core that it works for. When I'm done with it, it'll also have other information like a configuration page, but we're not going to build that today, so we'll add that later. We also need to add a module file, or we won't be able to turn it on. Oh boy, didn't check this window. Can you guys see that yet? Okay, so I am inside the module folder, inside the folder that's the name of my module here, which is on the web. For starters, I threw all the images. These are all the social media icons that were in the module in Drupal 7. I just threw them in here, and I've converted my info file. So the first thing I'm going to do is create a module file. And I am not a super nerdy developer, so I don't have an IDE. I'll probably need to get one to work in Drupal 8. I use TextMate, so I'll open that up in my text editor. Module file needs to start with a PHP tag. Probably have a little doc block, all the good stuff you know and love. But because in Drupal 8 land, in order to provide a block, I do not need to implement a hook. I need to have this module file with a PHP tag in it, but it doesn't actually need to have any code in it. What I need to do now is go turn it on. Yay, a module that does nothing. Ta-da, we're done. Drupal 8 module. You excited? No. All right, so what we're going to do is build a plugin, which is how you do blocks in Drupal 8 land. Well, okay, let's go do that. So in order to do that, the first thing I need to do is add a directory in here called lib, and then go into lib, and then inside lib, I need to create a directory called Drupal. And then into that we go. And then I need to make another directory called on the, if I can type correctly, web, name of my module. And then into there we go. And now I make another directory. Let's see, that's called plugins. Maybe singular. Lib Drupal plugin, I think it's plural. Anyone know? Okay. We'll try it. We'll see. Then into plugin we go. And the plugin we're making here is a block. So we make one more directory. Okay. So now we're here. So now inside this this folder, we can create the actual plugin we want to use. So I'm going to cheat here. Okay. So it's called on the web block, just to make sure. Okay, we'll open that up in TextMate. Ha ha. All right. So now I have a block, almost. Where's my example? Nope. Okay, no, that's not it either. All right. There we go. So. This is not very exciting. We'll just copy this whole thing. At least. Is the right one? No. Too many. Windows. There we go. Oh. Okay. So in here, we just tell a little doc block that says what's inside it. We've got a fancy class here called OnTheWebBlock. We've defined a namespace. And we're telling Drupal the things that we need to use in order to create the block. Not very exciting. We're making a block, so we need access to the blocks. We're creating an annotation. That's what this fancy little thing is here at the top in this comment. So we need access to that. And we're going to need to translate the name of that annotation, so we need access to that information as well. So we will use statements at the top. You can copy this from other modules in core or read some documentation or however you want to figure it out, whatever your module needs. But what we're having here is we're defining a class here that says on the web block extends block base. So we're basically taking a block and making our own version of it. And so my previous module, so this is the Drupal 7 version. So we have here a hook, right, that has a bunch of different operations. This is the view operation hook. And what we have here is we're just defining an array that says here's a subject and here's the content. In my module, this happened to be a helper function that had the printed out the content. And I had a giant function that took a whole bunch of settings and printed out some information about that block. Inside here, we're not going to do all the variable get set stuff because that's really different in Drupal 8. But all we basically do is loop through a bunch of services, which we still need to do in Drupal 8. And then for each service, we're going to print out a linked icon that links to wherever. So we're going to do that same thing. In Drupal 8 land, we're going to have a list of services. I don't know if this is the right way to do this. This is just some helper function that generates the list. Here's my helper function. It's a yucky procedural function, but I'm going to throw it in my module file where I'm allowed to put yucky procedural functions. So just in here like this. Just delete this extra white space for fun. OK, so here's my yucky procedural function. And it says, hey, here's a list of available services. So in Drupal 7, we love arrays, so I created arrays of arrays, because that's all great. And then all we need to do in Drupal 8 land, plop the same thing in, and then we're going to get the list of available services. Drupal 8 land, here's my block. Oh, little aside here. So in Drupal 8, instead of having a hook, instead we create a public function inside this class. So let me go grab the code for that so I don't type it wrong. Example, plugin. There's a bunch of other stuff I'm doing in here we don't need to do yet. So here's a public function build. This is basically equivalent to the hook block view as we had in before. And I think I have actually a simpler example of it down here. Start with that one. See if it works. So, public function build. So what I'm doing here is hard coding a bunch of the stuff that we had settings for in Drupal 7 land. Like the alternate text is always going to say find us on wherever. The link is always going to go to Google, and then I have a list here of services, which I'll pull in. I'm going to start to assemble a string, which in Themeland, we always really hate assembling strings, but we're going to do that anyway. I've got a count, and I've got a loop. So we're going to loop over each of these services. We're going to create a list of classes, which, of course, front-enders hate when module developers add classes, but that's what we do in Drupal 7. And then we're going to go ahead and generate some attributes, in this case, the title tag. We're going to attach that link. And then we're going to print the output by calling a theme function. So if we look really quickly back at how this theme function thing worked in Drupal 7 land, I called here one function to generate a linked image, which was called theme on the web item. And then after I had the on the web item linked image, then I called another theme function on the web icon. Themers love this, right? This is great. And then if you actually look at the theme hook that was defined in my module, there's actually a third one called theme on the web image, because you always need theme functions to call other theme functions, right? Because themers love that. So what I'm going to do instead of providing three theme functions that all do very little, instead I'm going to consolidate these into one thing for Drupal 8. So if we look first at what theme on the web image did in Drupal 7, it took a service like Facebook, a title like find us on Facebook, the preferred size of the image, and then it created a bunch of variables to pass into the theme image function. That really sucks, right? I did that. It's okay. You can say it sucks. Instead, what we should be doing is using the theme image function, passing it a bunch of variables, and giving it a suggestion so that rather than wrapping one theme function in another theme function, just say, if you want to override the theme image function, but only for these icons, we're going to view a way to do that. So in Drupal 8, I'm going to call, let's first define theme hook. So where's our example? Hook theme. Okay. We still have a hook theme in Drupal 8 for now, who knows. So we're going to drop that into the module file. Drupal 7, Drupal 8 module. Okay, so this works almost exactly the same way as it did in Drupal 7. This will look really familiar to most of you. We've got the name of the module, hook theme, right? Inside there, we have the name of the theme functions. One we've got here is called on the web item. We've got the variables that you pass to it. And then even in Drupal 7, if you had provided a template, you would have just added the template indicator in this theme hook array here. So we're going to do that exact same thing in Drupal 8. To draw a parallel between that and Drupal 7, I'm just going to dig a little bit deeper into what was going on in Drupal 7 land. So let's just walk through this all the way from the beginning. Block view. Okay, so I called this function on the web display block. And in that function, we looped through all of our services. We built a link image by calling theme on the web item. Inside theme on the web item, we called theme on the web image, got the image, added a bunch of attributes, and then linked it by calling L. Then once we had a linked image, we called theme on the web icon. In theme on the web icon, we wrapped the linked image in a span tag. So all we're doing is adding a span tag around an image, and that took three theme functions. Bad idea. Okay, so how would we do that same thing in Drupal 8? We're gonna consolidate and reverse engineer a little bit here. So we have we're gonna start by creating a one single theme function that does all of these things, and then we're gonna turn that theme function into a Twig template so you can see how that works. So, Drupal 8. Example. Okay, so here's the theme function in Drupal 8 land. Okay, so here's the theme on the web item function. We're gonna start by taking the service, the link it's gonna link to, the title attribute. We're gonna build a path based on the size that's requested. Again, I'm not asking the user for the size here, so we're just going to assume it's small. We're going to build the image tag. So instead of creating our own theme function and wrapping it around theme image, instead I'm going to call theme image with a double underscore and a particular suggestion. So now when theme image gets called, you can say for on the web, if there's a specific template override or theme override, it'll use that instead. If it's not, it'll fall back nicely to just use the standard image handling. So we're not doing anything special in my contrib module to make that yucky for themers. Then I'm passing in all those variables that I established earlier, which are hard to see. And then I'm going to set up some additional attributes, like adding a HTML title attribute here. And then I'm going to link the image just by calling L, passing in the attributes. And then I'm going to build the classes. This is the same theme function. And then I'm going to wrap it in a span tag. So one theme function that does all of it. OK, so there's a theme function version of that. In order to get this to work, of course, we don't include the template here. Let's go rebuild the theme registry and see if the errors go away. Haha. OK. So rebuild the theme registry because we added a bunch of new stuff. Why don't we just use the example module? Since we're running out of time. I'm gonna use the class theme here. Oh, not that one. This one. And not the pre-process function. Also need making sure. Let's try that again. Six minutes, come on. Do. Yay, Drupal 8. Live demo. Remember when I told you this wasn't a good idea? Yeah. All right, so in theory, that should work. Let's skip ahead. We're going to go on to the pre-process. Oh, I see.
By the way, Jen, we have till 3:15, I think it is.
Oh, OK, good.
So.
OK.
Take a breath.
All right, we can make this work, maybe. All right. By the way, if anyone has any ideas and want to help me out, that's fine, too. This is the template preprocess. This is the theme. Theme hook. Try it again. Well, that could be it. Plug in. Hmm. is not.
Are you talking from your example to a text?
Yeah.
Okay. Does it look like the dot module or the class had the dot module stuff?
That's what I was thinking too. Although. Okay. Aha. Thank you. Okay, let's try that again. Putting your files in the folders is a good idea. Thinking harder than the last time.
That's all life, so you'll never make this mistake.
All right, cache has got cleared. Already on the right track here. Okay, so let's go turn on a module or a block. Already turned on a module. Block layout on the web block. All right, let's see. We're going to explicitly request Twitter and Facebook to link to Google. I'm going to put it into the, oh man. All right, there's a bug. It's all right. We're in alpha. No problem. Can do this. Let's see. Move this into a sidebar, maybe. All right, let's see what happened. Ha-ha! So it doesn't like, it's missing a variable. That's all right. We've got Facebook and Twitter icons and they link to Google. Yeah. Okay, so we got our theme function working. Glad you guys are bearing with me through all of that. But theme functions, as we all know, are on the way out. We don't like theme functions anymore. We don't like PHP code. We want fancy Twig stuff. So the change to make your theme function into fancy Twig stuff is to define a template file, right? And of course then need to create that template file. Template files in Drupal land, Drupal 8 land, way back up here. Okay. So we're going to create a directory called templates. So everywhere you need templates, you're going to have a templates directory with templates in them. And here, templates are called html.twig because they are mostly HTML. Oh, sorry. Okay, so what does a template look like? You've probably seen some of them already. We decided to start them with the standard PHP doc block, which sounds crazy, but that was actually the easiest parsing we could do. And we're just gonna wrap that PHP doc block inside a Twig doc block, or Twig comment indicator. And then just as you would do in Drupal 7 land, you just put all of your normal comments in there. So templates, if you're a contrib maintainer, you need to worry about this. If you're just building your own stuff, you probably don't, unless there's other people on the project you want to be nice to. Where's my other window? Nope. All right, so what we're gonna do here, this just says, you know, default theme implementation, we're gonna have two variables, the icon itself, the attributes that we're gonna be printing into it, and then we're specifying in particular the classes. We're not gonna be adding IDs or any other data attributes, just the classes, but if you wanted to print them all out and add your own data attributes or whatever, you could. And then inside here, we're gonna put a span tag. Whoa, HTML, crazy, not spam. inside the span tag, we're going to print the icon and add attributes, just the class. No. Did I spell that right? A-T-T-R-I-B-U, yes. Okay, so there's a template. Again, in the real world, having a template with a span tag in it is probably not like a best practice, right? That's a lot of templates for not a lot of code. But this is definitely better than having three theme functions that did this exact same thing. So getting better. In order to make this work, we need to take our theme function, right, which is how we did things when in Drupal 7 land, and turn this into a pre-process function instead. So we're just going to take the whole function, or actually, do I need to do that here? We're just going to rename this template preprocess. One thing that's really important to remember is that you need to add an ampersand before the variable. So if you're converting your own and wondering why it's not working, that's super important. I forget that all the time. We're going to take, instead of concatenating a string like we did here, instead we're just going to take all of the variables we actually need and stick them into the variables array, which will then enable us to print them out inside the Twig template. So here we have the linked image is what's going to be our icon. So this should just be variables of icon. The classes need to be an attribute. And then that's all we need. So we can delete this whole output line. We can delete the return line. Don't need that. And instead, this is going to be variables of attributes. And then here, this needs to be structured a little bit differently. Attributes are super fancy. In Drupal 8, they're this awesome, crazy, classy thing that prints itself into a string, which you can look into in more details. But all you really need to know here is that we're going to pass in only classes.
And this stuff is a moving target, too, because we do that automatically now.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
So do I not need to cast this?
Correct. Just an array.
Wow.
Magic.
Like that?
Yeah, that's good.
Okay, so if you name it attributes, it'll be magical. If you name it something else, it won't be. Okay, got it.
Well, yeah, I think there's attributes, title attributes, and content attributes are all magical.
Okay. Magic. And then this is, this is an array of, yeah, that looks right. Okay, so now we have a variables of icon and a variables of attributes. Did I spell that right? It looks like it. So template preprocess, and I should have defined a template. This should work. Cross your fingers. Here we go. Back to my clear all caches page. Come on, creating a span tag. You can do it.
By the way, Jen, do you have Twig debug on?
No.
You should turn it on.
Okay. Oh, okay. Let's see if it worked. Should be exactly the same. Yay! Okay, that was a lot of fanfare for something being excellent. Okay, so let's go turn on Twig debug so you can see what that looks like. I can show you some source code.
Yes, and we can prove that it's Twig.
Sites default. Let's do this so you can see it. Oop. That was earlier this week, sorry. Okay, so Twig debug. Here's this magic little settings thing inside my settings.php. I'm just going to uncomment it. Twig debug equals true. Yes, I really want to overwrite that. Just for fun, clear all the caches again, because we like clearing caches. Dun, dun. We need a cache clear song. Apparently, I just make them up if we don't have one. All right, So this should also be exactly the same. Eventually, I'll go fix that count error. But OK, let's look at some source code, shall we? Facebook. OK. So here we have our span tag. It's telling us here.
Can you blow that up?
Oh, sorry. Yeah, that'll be good, so you can read it too.
Yay.
All right, so this theme debug indicator says, hey, the thing that comes next is being printed through a Twig template. Is that still big enough? Make it bigger. And it says the function that was called here is theme on the web item. And then it says, hey, here's the output. So here's our span tag with our fancy classes. Obviously, there's no count because I was throwing that error. But you've got an on the web class, an on the web Facebook class, and an on the web zero, whatever it is, class. A link that links to Google, a title attribute that says to find us on Facebook, and a fancy image tag, which includes all of this stuff that comes from core. So like we've got RDF module turned on, or I don't know where this is coming from, but there's data attributes being added to the image tag I don't need to worry about because I leveraged Drupal to get that for me. It's using my image styles, or defined size here. I guess it's not an image style. Pulled it correctly out of the module, and it's got alt and title tag on there, and my span tag took me half an hour to create on there as well. Pretty exciting? Are there any questions about that? Anyone awake? No. All right, so in general, if you're a contrib module developer and you've got a bunch of theme functions, upgrading from 7 to 8 is a really good chance to give you, to evaluate, do you actually need those theme functions? I had one I obviously didn't need at all. It was the wrapper on the theme image function. And then I had two other ones that could be consolidated into one. To be fair to myself, I did have good reasons for putting those in when I did, because it did it in the middle of the Drupal 7 cycle, and I didn't want to break existing theme overrides people had had. So I just put a wrapper theme function around the one that was already there so that stuff wouldn't break. But now, Drupal 8, time to clean slate all of that. So combine those into one. And then once you have your single last theme function, it's really easy to convert that into a Twig template just by taking your theme function, turning it into a pre-processed function, passing your variables into that array, writing the template with the content in it that you need, and pulling the stuff out of that variables array in fancy Twig syntax and printing them to the page. So you end up with something much prettier and easier for front-enders to work with. Hopefully, not without too much pain. Yay. Yes, question in the back. So this code is currently on Drupal.org. It is a contributed module. If you go to the version control tab, you can grab the 8.x version. Again, it still needs some work, right? Because it's throwing errors and stuff. But the code that I demoed today is all there. You can grab it. I'll get the other stuff upgraded too, and you can see how that works too. But yeah, it's there. Was there another question? No, no more. Okay, thanks, guys.
Oh. And I think we were also supposed to do that survey thing. I don't know if Morten has. Do you have that, Morten?
I have something that's way more important.
Anyway, you're supposed to. It would be nice. Yeah, you can tell us how we did.
So we really want to. Especially, I want to have some feedback to figure out if people actually understood what I was talking about. Because I'm going to take this slideshow kind of on the road and probably going to do a couple of screencasts around it to make more people figure out where we are right now to get more people in. But anyways, it's really, really nice to get some feedback on these sessions. This is the first time DrupalCon tries out these 2 hours events. So figuring out if this is too long, is we're way too boring, you know, all of these things, we really need to appreciate your feedback. So if you go in on the DrupalCon website, there's a form you can fill out. Of course, we forgot all about the address of that because we are idiots. Anyway, way more important. I just saw this tweet. I hate theming in Drupal, but now there's Twig. My heart is open for theming in Drupal. I am happier. I think when I see those kind of things, I'm kind of down for one more year of battling. So, but I want to have you with it. tomorrow we're going to have the buff, and the whole thing around that is actually getting figure out where you guys want to push it, where we want to push it, try to make a plan for it, try to make a plan forward, what things we're going to put into core, what we're going to do in contrib, figuring all of these things out. That's going to be tomorrow at the 2:15. Even more important, the code sprint on Friday, it's even if you have like half an hour, still come by, just show your interest in actually making our machine go a little bit more. You know, when you go at 3 o'clock in the morning battling with a patch, they're just going to hate you. Figuring out if we're doing it right or wrong is really, really important. So please talk with us, even if you just want to give us support or tell us that we are completely wrong. That's also good. Now, talking about things that would be completely wrong to do is, of course, to go out and drink gin lanterns, which is actually a drink invented by gin lanterns. So today at the Corinthia Bar, which is this hotel bar right over here, they have Malibu rum. I spotted that. I'm not sure if they have this evil cranberry stuff, and I'm a little bit afraid of it because I've never tasted it. I only smelled it, and it smells awful. But Jen loves it, and I always know when she's in the same bar as me because I can smell that awful, awful coconut crap. But today I want to try it. And I just saw afterwards, actually, so later tonight, apparently there's a beer garden, like down there's our hotel, this is the conference, and up there's the a beer garden that can hold hopefully a ton of people. We're going to go up there and get ourselves ridiculously drunk and celebrate that we can now do decent for loops and decent markup in Drupal 8. And I think you should all come and join us. It's also on the Prague website, on the social events. It's called something about sightseeing or something. It's so for once, it's not me who's calling the shots, and I'm glad for that. Anything else, last words?
What does it mean? Let's try it again. What is it? Do you want to just pull this slide up?
It's 2:15, so we have to stop now, actually.
Yes.
Thank you all for coming. It's kind of nice to actually see that people are interested in this work we're going to do, and we're looking forward to see you all tomorrow at the buff, later at that, the code sprint. Earlier for that, for the drinking gin lanterns over at the Corinthia Bar, and even later for that, for being dumb in a bar. So thank you all for coming.
And I'll just add quickly, because this is a lab and because it's new, it would be interesting to know if you can give us some quick feedback. What were you expecting? What did you want to get out of this? And did we do it? Or like, if we do this again in 3 months, you know, how could we do it better to help you out? Because that's ultimately what we want to do. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
So we were talking about the possibility.